Good morning and welcome back to social psychology. Welcome to the Schnupper Schüler again. No alcohol, no drugs, no cigarettes are allowed in this lecture theater. It's different from your schools here. Today we will be talking about attitudes. Attitudes are probably the most important topic in social psychology, and social psychological research on attitude has been extremely influential also for many other disciplines in psychology, but also in other disciplines such as economics or sociology. Today we will talk about the fundamentals of attitudes and where they come from and how they develop and what they are in the first place. Next week we will be talking about how we can change people's attitude and how persuasion works, or how we might better resist persuasion attempts. But let's briefly talk about the multiple choice questions from last week. We will talk about Leon Festinger today again when we talk about his cognitive dissonance theory, or theory of cognitive dissonance, which he developed in 1957. In 1954, he developed another theory that provides you the answer to that question. According to Festinger, people learn about themselves by ignoring the comments of others and looking to the future, playing up their strengths rather than their weaknesses, comparing themselves with others, or putting their past behind this. Any idea? How do people learn about themselves? What do they do?
Comparing themselves with others.
Correct. See, comparing themselves to others. In 1954, Leon Festinger developed social comparison theory that we discussed last week as one element of getting to know ourselves better and also helping with some strategies that we discuss in a moment. 97% of the 50-plus people who participated in the assessment online got this one right. I think I already mentioned we upload the slides directly after the lecture, again in the same format that I present them here. So after the lecture, we also include the multiple choice questions and the answers to them. And we have also uploaded the videos on YouTube. So from now on, maybe one or two days later, you can also watch the videos just from clicking on YouTube and going on my channel or the MOOC channel, so you don't have to log in every time. And it's also possible for people to watch the lectures who are not registered in this course. We have some guests. Also, the Schnupper Schüler can watch the videos on YouTube. Which of these refers to self-concept in a relatively collective sense? Social identity, personal identity, the ideal self, or the looking glass self? Bitte. Social identity. That one is, I think, easy. We talked about the three dimensions of identity, or three aspects of self. We can define ourselves or conceptualize our identity in terms of the collective, the group, the society we are members in. In terms of a personal identity, who we are as individuals with our individual strengths and weaknesses and characteristics, or the relational self or relational identity, me in relation to one other person, my partner, my child, my boss, etc. Again, 90% got this one right. Social identity is the correct answer. According to Konstantin Sidikidis in 1993, self-enhancement, self-verification, and self-assessment are powerful types of self-motives, self-serving biases, illusions of self-control, or egocentric strategies. But what do you feel might be the right answer? Then you belong to the 15% of people who didn't get it right. It's self-motives. So B would be self-serving biases, that things we do to feel better afterwards, not necessarily to find out who we are and how good we are. So a self-serving bias would be self-enhancement or self-verification. But self-assessment is a true motive to find out who we really are, how good we really are. As I said, self-enhancement is probably the dominant of these three self-motives, and self-assessment is only very distal or not very often used. But these three things are all self-motives. Okay? Final question. In the context of disadvantaged groups, which strategy can young people employ to maintain a positive self-esteem? They can, for example, identify ethnic characteristics that they perceive in a positive way. They can stick to themselves and congregate in specifically designed or designated areas, keep to themselves, or assimilate. What can young people who belong to disadvantaged groups employ to maintain positive self-esteem? Sie? Nee, Sie. Wir wollen nicht. Why not?
Me?
No. Ja, bitte.
A.
Then you belong to the 75% of people who were correctly answering this question. They can identify particularly ethnic characteristics that they perceive in a positive way. This is a typical thing that you observe when people belong to disadvantaged groups. It may be ethnic groups, it may be other groups. We will be talking about this when we talk about people in groups and the lecture on prejudice again. But let me just give you two examples. One example in the 1960s in the American civil rights movement was that black people identified with certain characteristics of their group, like being good in music or sports. And then they invented this notion of black is beautiful. So they knew that they were in a disadvantaged group. They knew they were of much lower status than the average white group. But they identified certain characteristics that they knew would positively distinguish their group from the majority group, and that helped them maintain positive social identity. Okay, we posted two questions on the forum. One was related to this article where General Alexander defended the NSA's espionage on Chancellor Merkel and others. And there were some interesting postings in this forum. And the question was, how can we relate this to terror management theory? Remember last week we talked about terror management theory as a theory that claims we are aware that we are mortal, that we eventually will all die. And that makes us terrifying. It's not nice to think about our own deaths, and we can experimentally instill a notion of mortality by showing death videos to people, and then they typically look for something where they can maintain positive self-esteem again, and they try to construct the world in a way that is less threatening to them. And there were some interesting postings, and some people rightly said that the NSA or politicians in the US at the moment are utilizing some sort of terror management theories argumentations or line of argumentation by claiming that this all protects us from terror, from terroristic attacks. So they play with people's fear about bad things that can happen to defend what they are doing. And all the people who participated in the forum said, obviously you cannot defended by relating to these arguments. And what they may also do, and this was some way apart from terror management theory, but I found this an interesting thing. What they really do is they are fearful of their own political death, because the NSA obviously is under great pressure at the moment to justify what they are doing. And because they are fearful of their own political death, they have to do anything to maintain their own personal self-esteem. Another question that we posed was, how might group membership lead to a negative view of the self? Consider gender and ethnicity in this light. And there was one longer posting by someone from Peru, and this person said that as a teenager, he was not very strongly identified with Peru, and quite the opposite. He remembers not thinking very highly of his country or the people in it, but he didn't develop a negative sense of self-image because of that. But he felt that he simply didn't belong here, and one of his goals was to find a way to move elsewhere and start over. But over time, this has changed, and he is no longer feeling so negative about Peru, but he obviously considers that there are some aspects that need to be improved. But he remembers the need to exclude himself from his group at the time. And I think that's what we often observe, and as we discuss 2 weeks from now, the problem is that for some groups, it's much easier to exclude ourselves. But it's so much more difficult when you belong to groups where ethnicity or, for example, gender is obvious. And when we are constantly categorized into that group by others, and group boundaries are less permeable. Someone from Peru can, for example, move to another Spanish-speaking country or Portuguese-speaking country. He can go to Chile or wherever and can leave his Peruvian identity in some way. But that's much more difficult for a woman becoming a man or vice versa, or for someone with black, dark skin color becoming a white person. It's simply not possible. Group boundaries are not permeable, and that to a large extent influences the strategies that we can or could use to cope with negative identities. We will talk about this in a few weeks. Okay, here are some terms. Teaching objectives for today, we talk a little bit about the structure and function of attitudes. We will talk about the very important question whether attitudes can influence their behavior. We talk a little bit about where attitudes come from and how we can measure them. As I already said, attitudes have been researched by social psychologists for a long time, and some textbooks refer to the topic of attitude research as the most important contribution of social psychology. This is a typical or classic definition. Attitudes are relatively enduring organizations of our beliefs, feelings, and behavioral tendencies toward any socially significant object, group, events, or symbols. So we can have attitudes about almost anything, objects, people, as long as they are socially relevant. It's a relatively enduring thing. So the relatively enduring part of this definition means we don't switch our attitudes every few seconds. Once we have developed an attitude towards a socially relevant object, we typically maintain this attitude for a while. And it comprises beliefs, feelings, and behavioral tendencies. And when we use just one example, condom use. Which attitudes would you have about using condoms when you have sexual intercourse? And this comprises a set of beliefs that is relatively enduring about a socially relevant object that comprises cognitions, your own cognitions about other people, and also behavioral tendencies. And we can a little bit more easily structure this set of beliefs, feelings, and behavioral tendencies by referring to attitudes based on the ABC model. A would be the affective component. This is a person's emotions and affect towards the object. Think about Chancellor Merkel. You would easily have an affective attitude towards her. You either like or dislike her. The second component is the, The second component is the behavioral component, how the person tends to act towards the object. It's very important that we don't refer to the behavior as such, but our tendency to act or our behavioral intention. So the intention part is part of the attitude that predicts or not predicts, as we later see, our real behavior. But the intention is part of the attitude. So you may think about voting or not voting for Merkel and the CDU in the next election. You have a feeling, the affective component, you like or dislike her, a behavioral component, your intention to vote or not to vote for her, and the cognitive component. And this comprises any thoughts or beliefs you hold cognitively about Angela Merkel. You have some factual information about her background. You know that, may know that she's a physicist, that they grew up in the eastern part of Germany. You know that she's chancellor for quite some time, that she has been formerly secretary of environmental matters, etc., etc. So a set of cognitive beliefs. And these are not always highly correlated. Sometimes we have cognitions, thoughts and beliefs about Angela Merkel, where you probably think, okay, she's quite a good chancellor because she has done X, Y, Z to overcome the financial crisis, and you may like the way she has dealt with the financial crisis, but you may still not like her. And because you don't like her, you will not vote for her. Or vice versa, you hold some extremely negative cognitive components. You may not have liked at all how she has dealt with the nuclear energy thing, but you may like her because she's a better chancellor as a woman than all the men before her have been, and the alternatives we might see, and therefore you are going to elect her, although you have negative cognitions, etc., etc. So sometimes these components are highly, strongly related, sometimes they are not. And in principle, we can say that attitudes are often cognitively very complex. We do have many thoughts and beliefs about a certain object, but effectively or evaluatively, they can be very simple. Like with Angela Merkel. If you think about her for a moment, you may come up with a list of 50 different thoughts that come to your mind. Factual information, beliefs about her past behavior, etc. But evaluatively, it's relatively simple. Many people, most people have very effectively very simple attitudes towards politicians. Either you like them or you don't like them. The fact that our attitudes are relatively enduring set of our, or relatively enduring organization of our affective, cognitive, and behavioral tendencies also make it possible to access related information relatively fast and to base our decisions based on this information relatively quickly. So some of you may prefer the Green Party, some of you may support the Social Democrats or the CDU. Now imagine that a new person walks through the door and introduces him or herself as a member of either of these parties. Because most of you have formed a relatively enduring organizations of your feelings, thoughts, and behavioral tendencies towards these parties, you may immediately like or dislike this person. Because the information that is connected, related to this party membership is easily accessible in your mindset, and this leads you to make quick decisions. Attitudes are one determinant of our behavior, but not the only one. And conversely, does our behavior sometimes also influence our attitudes rather than the other way around, as we will see in a moment? Where do attitudes come from? We can use three basic theories or categories of theories to explain this. The first would be learning theories, then balance theory, and cognitive dissonance theory. Which learning theories do you know? Maybe the Schnupperschüler? Haben Sie schon mal gehört von Lerntheorien? Zeigen mal die Schnupperschüler auf, dass ich auch weiß, wen ich ansprechen kann. Also fast alle. Wer von Ihnen Schnupperschülern kennt eine Lerntheorie? Was fällt Ihnen ein, wenn Sie einen sabbernden Hund sich vorstellen? Schon mal gehört? Ja? Wunderbar. Ne? Der Hund hat schon angefangen zu sabbern, wenn er nur die Klingel gehört hat, nachdem man vorher ein paar Mal hintereinander immer die Klingel geläutet hat, wenn es Essen gegeben hat. Und das nennt man klassisches Konditionieren. Das ist eine berühmte Lerntheorie. Okay, there are more learning theories. And basically we can form our attitudes based on principles of learning theories of association, reinforcement, and imitation. These are the big three learning theories or broad branches of learning theories. We have classical conditioning, we have operant conditioning that works with reinforcement and punishment, and we learn through social imitation by observing other people behave and then behaving in the same way or similar ways. Association is a link in memory between stimuli that are related. Reinforcement and punishment is learning through learning particular responses because we are rewarded or penalized for showing this behavior. And imitation is matching thoughts, feelings, and behaviors after having observed others. And one application of the classical conditioning theory of attitude formation is the so-called transfer of affect research. Changing an attitude by transferring it to the affect that is associated with another object. So it's not about physiological responses like saliva, producing saliva. When we associate one object, that is the bell, with another object, which would be the food, here it's the affect that is associated with some objects that transfer to other objects. For example, transferring emotions from a sexy female model to the car she is standing by. This is a very, very common thing. Every year when the International Automotive Fair is opened here in Frankfurt and you see a short clip on the main news, you will always see beautiful women with little to dress on standing next to these extremely expensive cars. Because some people think that's what male customers will automatically lead them to associate the good-looking woman with qualities, characteristics, etc. of the other object, the car. How can we evaluate the learning approach? Is it helpful to understand how we form our attitudes? Yes, it is, but it also views people, as relatively passive recipients of external forces. And it's probably not the case that every male human being immediately is willing to pay a lot more for cars if it is advertised with beautiful women. We are not always very passive recipients and are easily influenced by external forces. When we talk about persuasion next week, we will see which routes to persuasion exist, why people may resist persuasion, and that it is much more often much more subtle than the advertisement industry may think. But this model seems to work well when people are completely unfamiliar with any material. So when it's a completely new car that is presented on the IAA, when it has features that we haven't seen in any other car, it's very, very innovatively designed, or it's a completely different motor technology or whatever, then these external forces, these other cues that we typically feel positive about, may help forming a positive attitude towards this new car and its features as well. So when the material is completely unfamiliar, yes, processes of classical conditioning, of forming the association by hardwired associations with other things may work. And the next approach is cognitive consistency, and we will discuss two approaches, balance theory and the theory of cognitive dissonance. They depict people as striving for coherence and meaning in their attitudes. This means that we typically don't want to hold two attitudes that are contradicting each other, or that we hold a positive attitude about something but not doing it, or vice versa. We strive for coherence in our set of attitudes and behaviors. One theory is Fritz Heider. Do you remember when we talked about Fritz Heider the last time? Second, which one was that? Gleichheit. Attribution, that's correct. Fritz Heider was the one who first talked about attribution and the notion that we are all naive scientists. And we all try to make sense of whatever we observe. Remember the little movie with the rectangles and moving around? So immediately we talk about these objects as if they were meaningful, as if they were people, and if their behavior had any cause and effect. And he said we basically attribute by distinguishing between internal or external forces that make us behave in certain ways. So in 1946, Heider developed the theory of balance, which addresses the need to maintain consistency among our feelings and beliefs about what goes together. And it considers the mutual evaluations of two people towards each other and each towards an object. So it's three things that need to be in balance or are in imbalance. And whenever you have three things that relate to each other, you have basically eight possible configurations. Mm-hmm. And these are examples, and that's most easily to understand working with examples. These are four combinations or configurations that create balance. This is Peter, this is Olivia, and this is an object. The object in principle could be a third person, but it's about two people and one object. These four triads are in balance. These four triads are not in balance. They are unbalanced. Here, for example, Peter likes Olivia. Olivia likes the opera, and Peter likes the opera as well. It's all perfect. Triads are also in balance when there are two negative and one positive relationship. Peter does not like Olivia. Peter does not like football, so he doesn't care whether Olivia likes football or not. Peter does not like Olivia. Olivia does not like exams. Peter likes exams, and that's fine. Peter likes Olivia, and both dislike the same object. It's also great. So whenever we have three positive or two negative and one positive relationship in this triad, we are in balance. When we have three negatives or one negative and two positives, the triad is not in balance, it's imbalanced. Peter likes Olivia, but he does not like dancing, whereas Olivia does like dancing. Peter likes playing classic music. He likes Olivia, but Olivia hates Beethoven or other classical music. Okay? When our cognitive system is in imbalance, we try to restore balance by changing one of the relationships in the triad. This is what balance theory predicts. So whenever the triads are imbalanced, it creates some sort of motivation. We don't like it, and this creates a motivation, a motive, a drive for changing one of the relationships. So Peter could, for example, change his attitude towards classical music. He can start listening to rap and hip-hop or whatever Olivia likes, and the triad would be more in balance again. He could also change his attitude towards Olivia. So when Olivia does not like classical music at all, there must be something wrong with her, so I don't like her anymore. Or he can try to make Olivia like classical music more by taking her to great concerts and explaining the music to her or whatever. I don't know whether it's on the next slide. Basically, the theory has been confirmed by research, but research has also shown that it does hurt much more when we like other people and this other person does not like or likes what we don't like or does not like what we like. This creates much more tension and a much larger drive to change the situation by either changing our attitude towards the object or by making the other person changing the attitude. It's less problematic, or research has shown that it is less problematic when we don't like the other person. When Peter does not like Olivia, he does not care so much whether Olivia votes for the same party than he does. Okay? So research generally supports the predictions of balance theory, but the balance pressure are much weaker when we dislike people than when we like them. And this has not been predicted by Heider. Heider was just assuming that every imbalance would create tension, and tension would lead to the drive to remove the imbalance. Okay, relatively simple. But observe this in your own environment. Think about the last time you fought with your partner or a very good friend about an object where you disagreed about. Think about people who you are relatively close to, who think differently about a third person. We don't like this. This is creating tension, and this can make us sometimes change our attitude. When I got to know my wife, she liked classical music a lot. So she was Olivia, I was Peter, and over the last 20 years, I've somewhat changed my attitudes towards classical music and like it more than I did like it 20 years ago. Okay, the other great theory, Leon Festinger, 1957. When was the theory of social comparison again? Hat sich irgendjemand gemerkt? 1950, about 3 years earlier than that theory? 50. Schnupperschüler, you need a lot of math in psychology. There's a lot of statistics and mathematics and. So 57 minus 3. Any? 1954, theory of social comparison, very influential theory, has instilled a lot of research. And 3 years later, Leon Festinger developed the theory of cognitive dissonance. And shortly afterwards, his student, Jacques Brehm, developed the theory of cognitive resistance. We will talk about this next week when we talk about persuasion and attempts to resist persuasion. Cognitive dissonance theory is concerned with discrepancies between people's attitudes and their behavior. It's an aversive motivational state. Again, we don't like it. It creates some tension when we observe that our behavior is inconsistent with our attitudes. And it's greatest when the attitude and behavior are both important to the self. Again, it creates psychological tension that we are all motivated to reduce. The classic example, next week I will present you the classic experiments, but the classic example for cognitive dissonance is smoking. We all have the attitude that we should behave some sort of in a healthy manner. Because of maybe terror management theory or what we have learned by doctors and teachers and parents and maybe also peers, we know that it is better to live on a good diet, not smoke, not drink too much alcohol, etc., etc. And we all know that smoking is very dangerous. And it's one of the objectives of every social psychological lecture that I make one person a non-smoker during the term. Is there any smoker among us that I can use as an example from now on? Okay, next week I will bring some pictures about lung cancer and all these things. He's an informatics student, so it's now my attempt to persuade him to stop smoking. And most of the times it has worked. So in 3 or 4 weeks you will have reduced your smoking. By the end of the lecture, I will only allow you to participate in the exam when you are a non-smoker. That helps a little. So what does this poor student thinks about his behavior and his attitudes? Obviously, he knows all these things. Smoking can cause cancer. Smoking can, or is responsible for a lot of other diseases and costs our health system billions of euros every year. He does know it. It's written on every package on cigarettes. And there will be more pictures in the near future. But he also has the attitude, I should live a healthy life, I want to become old and want to stay around in this wonderful life a little bit longer, I want to attend the social psychology lectures for the years to come and apply the knowledge, etc., etc. And he has this attitude, smoking is bad, I want to be a healthy person, but his behavior is the exact opposite of what he thinks. Now he has three options. Either he can change his behavior, stop smoking. Very difficult. I started smoking when I was 14 or 15, and I continued to do so until I was 35. And in these 20 years, I stopped smoking 7, 8 times, and I always tried very hard. But it's very difficult. Changing our behavior when we have hardwired, deeply held habits, it's much more difficult than we sometimes think. So the other option is change our attitudes. And that can be easier or more tricky depending on how deep we hold this attitude, how strongly our attitudes are related to other elements of our cognitive system, of our mindset. So what he probably does over, how long do you smoke?
30 years.
So over these 30 years, he has probably developed a lot of other attitudes. He has added consonant cognitions to his cognitive system that are in accord or in alignment with his behavior. Okay, smoking may eventually do some harm to me, but my great-grandparent was always a heavy smoker and he lived until his 90s. Look at Helmut Schmidt, he is a chain smoker and he is still quite bright and everyone listens to him. Or he may think, oh, I know a very good doctor. I have a former schoolmate who is now a doctor, and he will do a lung replacement when it's about time with me. He may also think, okay, I know that smoking is not very good for me, but I know it calms me down, and I need that because I live a hectic life, etc. He may also think about the costs involved of smoking, but then he thinks, but other costs are much more expensive. If I would stop smoking, I would probably eat more sweets, and they are expensive as well, etc., etc. So you are constantly trying to convince yourself, unconsciously or subconsciously, of course, that your behavior is not so much in dissonance with your attitudes as it initially looks like. Okay? So I will refer to you now every week. Oh, I already mentioned all this. Yeah. It can occur when we commit ourselves to a single course of action. In the very moment when you have made the decision to buy a certain pair of shoes or a certain car, and you commit yourself to this course of action, you start retrieving information that is confirming your choice of action, and you avoid information that might disconfirm it. And the research on it started with Festinger and colleagues observing a doomsday cult. The members of this cult predicted that at a certain day the world would end. And Festinger and one or two of his colleagues became members of this cult. So they did action research in a way. They became members of the cult, were taking part in the cult's active life, in the group's discussions, because they wanted to observe what happens when cult members see that their prophecy, their predictions that the world would end, would not hold true. They were interested in this, and they developed cognitive dissonance theory out of their observations. And what they observed was, against probably what we naturally would think is, okay, we strongly believe that the world does end in 4 weeks from now. We really strongly believe it's the center of our theological mindset or worldview. And then the world does not end. We are still around the next day. So what we typically assume is, yeah, then members kind of awake and leave the cult and turn to the next cult or go back to a Catholic church or whatever. But the opposite happened. The members of the cult became even more strongly believers in what they previously held. And they believed that their strong faith had helped save the world. And what they did was looking for other supporters. So they tried to lure more people to become members of the cult, because every member, every new member, would be another cognitive or consonant cognition to their mindset. Our mindset is a lot of cognitions about what we strongly believe in. And one of these strong cognitions was the world will end. The world did not end. This is now at odds with many other cognitions in the cult members' mindsets. Adding more people to the belief system adds more consonant cognitions. Okay? It's a wonderful book by Leon Festinger and Carl Smith, I think in 1962, when they described how they participated in the cult, what they observed, and how they came to define the theory of cognitive dissonance theory. And next week, I think I will present the three or four classic experiments that have been conducted between 1960 and 1980 that give you an idea about where cognitive dissonance might also play a role. Okay. Is there a link between attitudes and behavior? Are our attitudes in strong alignment with what we do? This has been a source of great controversy. And some people have said there's poor predictive validity, poor predictive power, so we should give up on the concept of attitude measurement and so on in the first place. Martin Fishbein, however, argued that attitudes can indeed predict our behavior. It depends on the level of specificity. If I want to make a good prediction about people's behavior, I need to measure their attitudes on the same level of specificity, with the same time frame in mind, etc. And then Fishbein and Martin Fishbein and Itzhak Eisen developed the theory of reasoned action, which I will explain in a moment. So how came researchers to say that there's poor predictive power of attitude measures for people's behavior? This started in 1934 with the now classic study of LaPierre. LaPierre was a US-American social psychologist. And in the 1930s, he toured the United States with a couple from Chinese that was visiting him. It was a colleague, another researcher with his wife, and together they visited 184 hotels and restaurants on their tour. They were refused service at only one establishment. So only in one hotel or restaurant, they were not given service. And this surprised LaPierre because the attitude in the 1930s of the average US American towards Asian people in general and Chinese people in particular was quite negative. So there was, for some reason, a high level of prejudice against Asian people. So he had expected to be refused more often, and he probably had expected to convince the Chinese couple that the Americans are not as bad as it seems, etc., etc. So he was surprised that out of the 184 hotels and restaurants, only one refused service. So he sent a survey around. After he came back, he sent surveys to all the hotels and restaurants that he visited. 128 of the 184 responded and completed the survey. 92% of them said that they would not accept Chinese people as guests in their hotels or restaurants. So 92% did hold prejudiced views and were not positive about Chinese people as guests in their restaurants. Their attitude was negative, clearly negative, but their behavior was not. And this led LaPierre, in 1934, he wrote it up and published it in a journal, Social Forces, which was a very influential journal at that time. And he made the strong claim that we should forget about measuring attitudes. Only in some very exceptional circumstances, attitudes might indeed be predictive of people's behavior. Okay, and for some time people thought, okay, maybe this is true and maybe attitudes are not good predictors of our behavior. And then some researchers thought about the moderating effects, the circumstances, the situations in which attitudes might indeed be better predictors and other situations, circumstances where they might not be good predictors. And they found a range of factors that lead to higher attitude behavior consistency. When attitudes are stable, we can better predict behavior out of measuring these stable attitudes. When attitudes are important to us, when they are very important to our mindset, when we consistently think about them, they lead to a better prediction of our behavior. When we are certain about our attitudes, these are obviously also in some way related or intertwined, but research has conceptualized or operationalized these things in different ways. As I mentioned earlier, in the ABC model, the affect, the condition, and cognition and behavioral tendency do not always need to be strongly correlated or interrelated. But particularly when our cognitive beliefs and the affective, the evaluative component correlate highly, then the attitude is a much better predictor of people's behavior than when it is not, when cognition and affect go apart. When they are easily accessed in our memory system, and when our attitude is formed through direct experience, when we have generated our mindset of cognition, affect, and behavioral tendencies toward, out of direct experience with the attitude object, it's more predictive of our own behavior than when we have only created our attitudes by observing or talking to others, by reading books, etc. Okay? This is a number of factors that should be considered when we measure attitudes, when we operationalize what we need to measure, what we want to measure, to be sure that we can predict behavior better later on. Yes, please.
Yeah, I have a question for, concerning the last slide. How do we know that the institutions didn't answer the survey following social norms? How do we know that this is their real attitude?
Okay, thank you very much. I've forgotten to mention, this is called the classic study by LaPierre. But it has been heavily criticized as well. It was published in a good journal, and maybe the great advantage of having had this study out was that it inspired a lot of research. And some researchers immediately said, oh, this can't be true. Let's go and do some proper research, because this was not proper research. LaPierre never intended it to be a study. So he only came to think about this inconsistency of his own perception of the American environment with the behavior observed after the event, and then he constructed the questionnaire and asked the institutions. And there are many problems. So cause and effect is not clear. It's not at all an experiment. We don't know which follows from which. We also don't know whether it's the same people. So he may have traveled the hotel on a Tuesday with completely different personnel accepting the Chinese people than the one who completed the questionnaire 4 weeks or 2 months later. So there are a lot of problems with this, and we don't know about their own attitude towards Asian people either. So maybe they had claimed in the questionnaire, I would refuse service, because there might be other American guests who may complain about this. Personally, I have good friends who are Chinese, and obviously I would do everything I can to maintain these friendships, etc. So thanks for asking. It's not a good study. But it's a classic study, and it has inspired our thinking, and it has inspired a lot of research that followed the 1934 publication of this study or experiment or however you might call it, but it does not comply to the rules and standards that we typically would have for a good study. We can distinguish between strong and weak attitudes. So if we combine some of these individually researched factors, some researchers have said we should have a concept called attitude strengths. And there are some weak attitudes and some strong attitudes, and with stronger attitudes we can better predict people's behavior, and stronger attitudes are attitudes that are more stable, personally relevant, and held about personally important issues about which we feel extreme and certain. If this all is the case, to a greater extent, then we have a stronger attitude. If one or more of these factors are less true, then our attitudes is more weak. Strong attitudes are embedded or tied into other beliefs, and they are often formed through direct experience and become highly accessible. Okay, so this is just to classify the number of factors we have seen on the previous slide. There were so many factors up until the 1940s, 50s that have been studied in individual papers, individual research projects, and here some researchers have said we should simply distinguish between strong and weak attitudes, and stronger attitudes are better predictors, and these were the number of factors, these were the factors that help distinguishing strong from weak attitudes. Stable attitudes obviously are accessible in memory, more likely to predict behavior. Attitudes that are expressed more frequently are also more accessible. Simple, very simple memory, fundamental memory processes. Maximum attitude behavior consistency occurs when attitudes and behaviors are measured at the same time. And the longer the interval, the lower is the correlation between the measured attitude and the ultimate behavior we want to predict. Okay, so these, yeah, please. Thank you very much. Let's take this as an example when we talk about the next theory or the next two theories. I think this is a good example. So, are people going to buy organic food? One theory that helps us better predict which people buy organic food or how strongly related their attitudes are to their ultimate behavior is the theory of reasoned action, developed by Martin Fishbein and Itzhak Eisen in 1974. It has been widely used for a range of things. I will show you some examples in a moment. And it's a relatively simple theory. This theory says that our behavior, whether we actually buy organic food or not, is determined by our behavioral intention. Do we intend to buy organic food the next time we do our shopping? The intention will relate to our behavior. Where does our intention come from? It comes from two factors. The first factor is our attitude. Which attitudes do we hold about buying organic food or consuming organic food? And the other is subjective social norms. What other people think, what other people want us to do. And behind these two boxes, we have expectancy value models. So our attitude is more complex again than just what do you think about organic food. It's a set of evaluations about the behavior's outcomes multiplied by the likelihood of each outcome. This is a cognitive component. What's the likelihood that my behavior leads to a certain outcome? And how do I like this outcome? How do I evaluate it? Is it positive or negative? So buying organic food, for example, what would my behavior to buy organic food create? And to make this more easy, Schnupper Schüler, this is higher mathematics, or somewhat higher mathematics. Our attitude is equivalent to the sum of our cognition and evaluation. The belief, the likelihood that our behavior leads to certain outcomes multiplied by our evaluation of that specific outcome, and this is summarized across a number of potential consequences. So buying organic food means with a pretty high chance I will pay more money for this food. Depending on whether I'm rich or poor, I will like this less or I don't care. It has also the consequence that I probably live more healthily. And if I'm young, I don't care. If I have already had several illnesses or whatever, I might care more and I might evaluate this outcome more positively. It may also lead me to the consequence of having a better consciousness or conscience, more positive conscience. I may feel better. Yeah, I'm doing something for the animals and it's better anyway. And I evaluate this strongly positively or not. And then you have three or four or five or more consequences. And you determine your attitude by evaluating these consequences in terms of how likely are they, and how much do I like them or not. But this is not the whole story. You may create a very positive attitude. The next question is, What do others think? What do my children think? What does my partner think? What does my neighbor think? What does whatever, my boss, my colleagues, my friends think about this behavior? And do they want me to do this? It's a normative expectation by others. What does my partner want? Multiplied by my motivation, what I typically do when I think about my partner's wishes or desires, commands, etc. Plus my children, multiplied by my motivation to follow what my children suggest, plus my neighbors, etc. And you see that sometimes attitude and subjective social norm may overlap, sometimes they do not. I'm telling you a lot about my children here, and Mel is a spy who passes it all on to my son. My son became a vegetarian 2 years ago. Sometimes he even thinks he's a vegan, which makes it even more complicated to cook and do the shopping, etc. So, and my daughter, who is 14, is also a vegetarian. My attitude toward eating meat is quite positive. Because the likelihood that it tastes good is high, and I evaluate good taste extremely positively. The likelihood that I do get the necessary amount of iron that I need for my blood production is very high. I evaluate that extremely positively. I like to have good blood. I do buy only organic meat from organic chicken and so on. So the likelihood that I do something negative to the environment is extremely low, and I evaluate that positively, etc., etc. But you can imagine on a Sunday when I cook meat for lunch, it's not so nice, because there are at least two people around the table who have a very high likelihood of not liking the meat I have cooked, and I'm at least somewhat motivated to do what these people want me to do. So we don't eat meat that often. So our subjective norm and our attitude may sometimes easily go together, sometimes it may be in conflict. And in a moment we will also see an extension of this model, but this is a summary table of some attitude objects and behaviors that have been studied using the Fishburne and Eisen model in the late 1970s. So after this model was around for 5-6 years, research has been summarized. And you see these were the criterion variables: having another child, using birth control pills, voting in the 1976 presidential election, having an abortion, or smoking marijuana. This is a correlation between the intention and the behavior. So going back to the model, if we measure people's intention, are you going to smoke marijuana the next 6 months? Will you vote for the conservative or the democratic president in the next election? Do you want to have another child in the next year? Do you want to use birth control pills, yes or no? These are the intentions, and this is how they are related to people's actual behavior. And you see that there are extremely high correlation. So when we measure people's intention, it's extremely highly correlated to their behavior. And what predicts our intention? This is the correlation between intention and the combined attitude and subjective norm. And you see our intention again is very highly related to this combined attitude times social or plus social norms. And here you see the attitude and social norm effect separated. And you see that for some items on this list of criterion variables, the attitude is less important than the social norm. So having another child, I may have very positive or negative attitudes towards this decision, but it's more important what my partner thinks. For others, it's opposite. It's a contrast. So for example, here you see a strong contrast, smoking marijuana. It seems a little less important what others think, because in these others, It's probably my parents, it's my neighbors, it's my boss, and they may all not like me smoking marijuana, but I have an extremely positive attitude about it. Not me, I mean others. Okay? But you see, and this is the answer to the initial question, can we predict behavior out of our attitude? And this table tells us, yes, we can. Oh, yes, we can. We only have to use good models. We only have to use good operationalizations. We only have to make sure that we measure the consequences that our behavior might have, and that we ask the people about each of these consequences, how likely they think they are, how much they like them or dislike them. And we have to make sure that we include people's beliefs about other people want them to do. Yes, please. So what we typically have is just an ordinary regression. We have the intention. Our behavior is somewhat equated to the intention. And the intention is a B of our, or say beta of our attitude, plus a beta of our subjective social norm, plus some error variance that we cannot explain. And the attitude is the sum of our whatever, B mal E, B times E. Our subjective norm is the sum of N times M. So it's a regression, and the B's are the weights of the regression equation. And it might be that this is positive and this is negative. And then as a result, depending on which one is larger, there might be a negative or a positive. Yeah.
And most students go there, you know, you don't live together if you're not married. But when they're in Australia, they do that. But they go back in Indonesia, they don't do that anymore, you know? So it's just like, and if you fit into this formula, that would work, because then there's the weighting that makes a difference of the social norm.
In the diploma oral exams, I always ask the question, how are the attitude and the subjective social norm component combined to predict our intention? Are they multiplied or are they additively combined? And what many students get wrong is they say they are multiplied, which I think is understandable, and I don't know about much research that has investigated this. I think often a multiplicative model might make sense. If I have a positive attitude, this may lead to much, much stronger intention when there's also a positive subjective norm, and vice versa when there's a negative subjective norm. The problem is that one of these components can be zero. So when I have a partner who is strongly in favor of doing me doing something, and I typically do what my partner wants me to do, but my colleagues or my boss just want the exact opposite, and I'm also motivated to do what my colleagues or my boss want. My wife may say, you should come home earlier. And I typically want to do what my wife wants me to do. But my boss wants me to stay longer in the office, and I typically also want to do what my boss wants me to do. And this results in a sum for the subjective norm that is zero. And if I had a multiplicative model, this would result in zero intention, no intention at all. And we typically don't have this all too often. So it's an additive model. And one of these components can be zero.
I would actually say the most important component is the beta.
The weights.
The weights, because in an Asian society, you put more weights into the pressure that comes from outside. mm-hmm. compared to the more individualistic mm-hmm. European norms, put it that way.
Okay.
And that changes the beta value for each individual.
And for the context in which the individual...
That would result in different mm-hmm. choice you make, irrespective of what your attitude is.
Maybe not completely irrespective, but it will strongly influence which of the components is the stronger one. Yeah, thank you. Okay, so this table tells us, yes, we can predict our behavior from our attitudes. We only have to measure it well. And how we measure attitudes, we will talk about in the next 10 minutes or so. But let me add one more model. 10 years or 12 years after the theory of reasoned action, Eisen and Madden developed the theory of planned behavior. And this is just one variable that is added to the original model, perceived behavioral control. People's belief whether they are able to control the outcome or not. So again, we have an attitude, we have a subjective norm, both predict the intention predicts our behavior, and now Eisen and Madden claim there's one more variable, perceived behavioral control. This variable also predicts our intention. So in the regression equation, we would have one more variable, and again with a beta or a B weight. But it also moderates the relationship between intention and behavior. And now thinking about organic food again. I may have a very strong positive attitude because I see many positive consequences for me consuming organic food, and I like these consequences. I also feel that my wife, my children, and my neighbors would also want me to buy organic food, and I typically I'm motivated to follow these attitudes. But I don't see that I have behavioral control over buying organic food because of many reasons. I may think organic food is much more expensive than other food, normal food. And I'm not rich, I don't have enough money to buy that. I may also think of, organic food is probably only offered in very specific supermarkets, and here in Frankfurt there's probably no such supermarket around. At the time when organic food was invented, this was the case. You didn't get it in the large supermarkets and everywhere. You had to travel a longer distance or had to go to specific places or buy it from some specific farmers directly. So this theory said that if we add this variable, we are even more able to predict people's intention, and this intention would predict the behavior even better. So taking the variable of perceived behavioral control is important. And then some people have done some research. Here's a study by Madden himself. Madden, a couple of years after developing this theory, has conducted a study in which he manipulated whether the criterion variable was under people's volitional control or not. So he asked people, using the theory of reasoned action and using the theory of planned behavior, about their intention and behavior to get enough sleep and to consummate additional vitamins. And as you can easily imagine, for the average person, taking vitamins or not is under almost complete volitional control. You just have to buy a little package of vitamin drugs, and then you either take one every morning or you do not take one. Getting enough sleep depends on many other factors. It depends on your friends, it depends on your neighbors, it depends on your children, it depends on your work. So many other people or other factors make us coming home late or not sleeping through the whole night or having to get up early the next morning, etc. So it's definitely not under complete volitional control of the individual. But people vary in the extent to which they think that they have perceived behavioral control or not. Some people may think, oh, I don't have any control. I cannot control whether my children sleep the night through or not. I don't have any control over when my boss expects me to be in the office every morning. And other people may think, oh, I may not have complete control over these things, but I can influence them to some degree. I can, for example, arrangements with my wife that whenever I have to get up early, she will take care of the children when they awake at night, and I will take care of them over the weekends, for example. So some people may have high perceived behavioral control, others may have lower perceived behavioral control. So this creates variation in this third variable that we would add to the regression equation. And you see that for the variable, for the criterion that is under behavioral control, it does not make a difference whether we use the theory of reasoned action or the theory of planned behavior. The correlation or the variance accounted for in the criterion variable. How are variance accounted for and correlation related? Machen wir doch mal ein bisschen Statistik. Varianzaufklärung und Korrelation. Oder umgekehrt, wenn Sie diese Korrelationen sehen, wie viel Prozent der Varianz im Kriterium können wir mit einer Korrelation von, sagen wir mal, Punkt 80 aufklären? Ja, bitte. Richtig, die Korrelation ist die Varianzaufklärung ist die quadrierte Korrelation. Umgekehrt heißt das, ist richtig, die quadrierte Korrelation, 8 mal 8 ist 64, ja. Umgekehrt heißt das, man muss hieraus die Wurzel ziehen, um auf die einfache Korrelation zu kommen. Das heißt, and that means we have explained variation of 0.5, 0.6, so we have a correlation between our intention and behavior using only attitudes and subjective norms of about 0.7, 0.8, and we also have about 0.7 or 0.8 when we use the theory of planned behavior and add the additional variable of perceived behavioral control. So no difference. When the behavior is our complete volitional control, asking people about perceived behavioral control does not add anything to the model. However, when it's not under volitional control for most people, then asking or taking into account this additional variable can make a lot of a difference. You see, for intention, the explained variation doubles, and for behavior, it even triples or increases four times. So the behavior, whether people actually sleep, is influenced by their attitudes and their subjective social norms. We can explain about 15% of variation in their actual behavior to get enough sleep or not. But when we take into account their perceived behavioral control, we can explain a little more than 40% of their variation. Okay? So this means the additional variable is very important, but only for some behaviors. And what's also important is our group memberships, the norms in our groups, and the extent to which we identify with our groups. And this is some sort of the subjective normative component broken down to personal and social identities. So our subjective social norm is not only our relational identities, it's not only by my partner, my child, my neighbor, it's also the collective self, the groups we are members of. And this is an experiment by Deborah Terry and Michael Hock in 1996. They asked students about their intention to engage in regular exercise. So do you want to do some sports over the next couple of months or weeks? And they asked them, are you members in certain groups? How strongly do you identify with these groups? And is it normative for the groups you are a member of to do regular exercise and to be a little bit more sporty? Or is it less normative? You see, for people who are if you are a member of a group that where sports is of low importance or less importance, people on average score 5 on a 7-point scale whether they intend to do regular exercise or not. When the norm in the group is pro-sports, pro-exercise, there's a strong norm towards regular exercise, it depends a lot whether people strongly identify with the group or not. The low identifiers, so the light blue bars, do not differ from the group with low importance of exercise, and they also score about 5 on this 7-point scale. The norms of the group kick in and change people's intentions and maybe also their behavior afterwards when it's normative and people strongly identify with their group. So this difference is highly significant, the interaction is highly significant, and this makes a difference. So for strong identifiers, exercising is a little less normative when it's not normative for the group, but it's much more normative when it's normative for the group. Low identifiers simply don't care about the group's norms. They exercise or exercise not, irrespectively of what the group wants them to do. Okay, and now a final couple of slides about measuring attitudes. Social psychologists have spent a lot of time and did a lot of research on how we can measure attitudes well. It's both important. Obviously, you can now imagine that it's very important that we measure attitudes correctly and appropriately and properly for making them predictive of our behavior, but it's also difficult. And I don't know, did you already have test theory? No? Diagnostics? You started with diagnostics, so you will learn all these scales in test theory or diagnostics as well. So we have scales like Thurston scale, Likert scale, we have Gutman's scalogram or Osgood's semantic differential. These are all techniques to measure attitudes verbatim. So we present items to people and ask them to agree or disagree with these items or tick whether they like or dislike the statements. And each of them have their advantages and disadvantages. Some, like a Thurston scale or a Goodman scale, are more difficult to construct, and therefore they are only less commonly used. The semantic differential of Osgood that presents just the evaluative dimension of an attitude object is very easy to construct. It's clear and simple to answer. It's a very direct measure of people's evaluation. But we don't know where this evaluation comes from. If we construct a Likert-type measure, and this is what you probably all have done whenever you completed a questionnaire, we typically have Likert-type scales and items. It's also relatively easy to construct, clear and simple to answer, but because we have multiple items and not just like or dislike, as with Osgood's differential, we can calculate the reliability of our measure, and we better know why people have a positive or a negative attitude about something. So Likert-type scales are the most commonly used ones. And you should know about these scales and these differences. So please read the chapter, because it will play a role in other seminars, in other lectures, and it's extremely important for your bachelor thesis. Because you will probably do an empirical project where you have to measure people's attitudes. And it's to know whether you know what the advantages and disadvantages of some of these scales are. Now, the problem with these types of measures, overt, explicit measures, is that people are either unwilling or unable to provide the correct answers. Typically, you know what a researcher wants you to do when you present these overt, explicit measures. If I would ask our little example student here how many cigarettes a day he smokes, and he may smoke 30 cigarettes a day, but when I ask him about how many cigarettes in a questionnaire, he may either be unwilling to provide the correct answer, and he reports a much lower number, or he may not correctly remember because he has suppressed the actual information. Okay? And this led researchers to come up with a number of more implicit, unobtrusive, hidden, subconscious ways to measure people's attitudes. We can use archival data. We can use behavioral measures that are unobtrusive. That means people don't realize that we observe their behavior. I will show you some examples in studies by Klink and Wagner in a couple of weeks' time. One experiment, for example, they have done was in a student house in Marburg. They offered on a blackboard, they offered lifts to other cities in Germany. So they said, I'm going to Hamburg next weekend and I can take two people with me and it costs 10 euro to share the price for the gasoline. The only thing they manipulated was the name of the person who made the offer. In one condition it was Peter Müller, in the other condition it was Ahmet Öztürk. You can imagine what happened. When the foreign Turkish name was used, many fewer people called, far fewer people called, than when the German name was used. This is an unobtrusive behavioral measure. One example for it. We can analyze people's language or nonverbal behavior. So I could invite you to an experiment over in the PEC building. And I can tell you, oh, you have to wait 15 minutes because there's just one other participant running the experiment, and please have a seat in the waiting room. And in the waiting room, there's, say, a foreign student. And I can measure whether you take the seat standing right next to the student, or whether you leave two or three or more chair space between you and this person who obviously is a foreigner, which is an unobtrusive, implicit method to maybe get to your implicit prejudice against foreigners. I can use physiological responses, like skin conductance responses, EEG, etc. I can use a bogus pipeline procedure. That is, in a way, telling people, okay, I'm now connecting you to a very expensive machine, and this machine actually knows the truth, knows your true attitudes. We need a few questions to validate the machine, and then through some techniques, I make the people believe that the machine actually knows the true attitudes. And then I present my real questionnaire, and the person is much more willing to answer honestly and not socially desirable. 2 minutes. I would briefly explain the implicit association test in a second, but I love the Dana et al. Study. This is one of my all-time favorite studies. It was published in 2001 in the Journal of Personality and Social Psychology. Let me very quickly look for a slide. I would like to show you the study. It's really one of the great studies that psychologists ever have done that shows the positive effect of optimism and humor and positive emotions. Dana et al. Were able to study CVs from an order of nuns in the United States. Every young lady who wanted to join the order had to had to submit a handwritten CV at the age of 17 or 18. And then they were accepted into the order or not. Those who were accepted into the order were doing the exact same thing for the next 40, 50, 60, 70 years. They lived in the same rooms, they had the same clothes, they eat or ate the same food, they had the same job. So it's some sort of naturalistic experiment that we obviously could never do. We could never have people living in the exact same environment for a long time. And Dana and colleagues used the handwritten CVs from the archives from the 1920s, around the 1920s, to classify 180 nuns into a positive and a negative group. The positive group was more describing their previous life with humor, with positive emotions. For example, Cecilia may have written, "Oh, I grew up with seven siblings. We never had enough space and never had enough food, but we always had a lot of fun and there were always someone to talk to." The less positive, less optimistic nun, let's call her Marguerite, said, "Oh, my life until now was terrible. I had seven siblings and we never had enough food and we didn't have enough space in the house and we were constantly fighting." Now, and remember, from then on, age 17 or 18, the same condition, same experimental condition, everyone, same clothes, food, rooms, job. The optimistic nuns, on average, were to 90% getting more than 85 years old, and at least 45% were over 94 years old, whereas the less optimistic nuns only were to 34% and 11% respectively 85 and 94 year old. The average difference was something like 9 years. So the more optimistic nuns at the age of 17 or 18 outlived the less optimistic ones by an average of 9 years, despite the exact same environment they lived in then for 70 plus years. Okay? So this is a great example of how we can use archival data to come up with good information that people were otherwise not able to submit. And the final thing is the implicit association test. And I would like you to do the test yourself. I would like you to go to implicit.harvard.edu. Harvard University has created this online test. You can select from a number of categories and you can play around a little bit with your own hidden prejudices. Explicitly, if I would ask any one of you, do you have prejudice against overweight people or Asian Americans or men or women or people with different sexual orientations or older or younger people? Probably no one would say yes, strongly. If you do this implicit association test, you may find that you have less positive attitudes than you actually think. And next week, I will talk a little bit more about the implicit association test. I wish you a wonderful week. Thank you for your attention.